Good evening, Facebook family. Welcome to another episode of Marriage Mondays with Nick and Trina Bresson. And we're here tonight to just give you some tips on how to make your marriage better. You know, we definitely do it from a God's perspective. So hopefully we can do this to put some insight and just give you some tips and skills to make your marriage better.
Mm-hmm. We do want to invite you to check out the webpage that we are coming to you from, our Facebook page, which is our church's Facebook page, which is Crown Kingdom Cultural Center. So if you type that in, it'll come up as a business Facebook page. We do have a group page, but we encourage you to use this page with the Crown logo on it. So we invite you also to come out to service. We have service mm-hmm. every Sunday at 10 a.m. And we have midweek services that are usually available online as well as in person. And we're getting back to being in the building. And that's a good thing, to be in the building. So we're there. We encourage you all to come out and visit with us for Bible study under the same roof. But if not, it is always available most of the time online. You can stream it. And usually on YouTube as well. It'll come up. We're on YouTube live. The church services are. And definitely afterwards. And Marriage Monday as well, after we record. It usually goes up on Facebook too. So we want you to get it however you can. We want you to like it, share it. Liking it helps with the algorithm and helps Facebook and YouTube to know that you like it. So maybe they'll suggest it to other people who might like it as well. So we want to circulate this information, help as many people as we can. And we're going to use technology to do it, because that's the day and age that we live in. So good evening, Alicia Mack. We appreciate mm-hmm. you for joining in with us. And you're always joining us and sharing us and commenting. And that's exactly what we want people to do. So we think we have a good lesson for you tonight. Something we can always be reminded of and always use in marriage. We're talking about alignment.
Mm-hmm. And what does that mean? All right. So when we're in alignment, and I'm just going to read you a quote by Stephanie James from this article. Okay. I guess I'll do that afterwards. I'll talk about what alignment looks like.
You can go in whatever order you want, but I would mind you,
Stephanie James?
Mm-hmm. Okay. We're going to quote him. We're going to give him credit.
It says, alignment in a relationship means that you're living and loving in the same direction, which is the way it should be done, as someone else. If you do not take the time and effort to align your vision, core values, passions with your partner, it will slowly start to take a toll on your relationships. Mm-hmm. And that's from Stephanie James from his article for relationship alignment. So when we're talking about alignment, the one way we can explain it is, and I also saw this from Pastor Tony Evans. Okay. And he talked about when you talk about the alignment of your car, you know your car needs alignment when a couple of things happen. When your car starts to shake and you don't know why, or when your tires wear unevenly. That means your alignment is out of order on your car. And if you don't get that alignment fixed, you're going to have some issues with your car, and you're going to buy tires without, you know, needing them for when they don't wear out purposely. And when tires wear out, when your alignment is bad, mm-hmm. the tires wear unevenly. That means the tire may be good on the right side, but the tires may be bad on the left side, because you're not driving on an even plane on those tires, and they're shaking, and it's causing it to wear away unevenly. But if you go get your alignment checked and fixed, your car drives better. Your car drives easier. You have your tires and everything that's going on with that car is going on in the same direction. So that's the alignment of your car is a good analogy for how you and your spouse should be when it comes to living this life.
It's interesting to me in that analogy that if you only address the unevenly worn tires, because you know sometimes they move the tires from the front to the back and mm-hmm. back to the front, they rotate them.
Right.
But if they are wearing down so unevenly that you're having to get new tires because of the way the wear and tear is. The tread?
The tread, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know nothing about cars, but I've been to mechanics enough to know that you do want your tires to wear down evenly. And if they're not, and you keep replacing the tires, but you don't address the alignment, and what's going to happen to your brand new tires?
They're going
to
wear the same way.
You'll have the exact same problem. So you tried to fix the problem by addressing the symptom, which was the tires, the way their tires were being worn down. But you will continue to have that same symptom if you don't address the root issue. And the root issue in this example is the alignment of the car. You got to get that axle. You know I knew that, did you?
I'm listening.
That's all I know. It's something about the axle. But that's right, isn't it?
Yeah.
And the axle is the part under the car. It's like the framework.
You don't have to fold that.
That's not right. Mm-mm. Okay.
But you're right with the axle.
Mm-hmm. But see, the axle is under the car. It's like straightened and have a place for the tires. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that's like what I mean by the framework. It's like the framework for the car. The whole car sits on that. And so if that's not aligned properly, the entire car is going to be off.
Right. You're right.
Mm-hmm. Pat me on my back because you know I was right.
You did good on that one. So, and like she said, if you don't fix that root problem, you're going to have the same situation. And that's why it's in your marriage, you're going to have those struggles. You're going to continue to have those frustrations unless you fix the alignment first. And we'll talk about why the alignment has to be fixed first, and then you can go from there. So with our discussion tonight, we're going to start right there. You know, we have to check our alignment because we want to have our efforts in the marriage to move in the same direction. You want your vision, your core values, mm-hmm. and your passion moving in the same direction.
Can I stop you right there, too? Mm-hmm. Because if you do not align you can't align your vision if you don't have one.
Okay.
So you're going to have a core problem right there. If you don't have a vision as a couple,
mm-hmm.
and if you don't have a vision and know what your life is supposed to be, what your purpose is, what the plans are, what God's plans are for you, you will not be aligned.
Hmm. And it's funny that you said that. I'm just going to deviate a little bit like I pastor do sometimes. This year.
Don't throw Bishop Bush out there.
I love that dude. I love that guy. And he said, you know, I'm just going to take a little excerpt
okay.
to kind of align what you're talking about. This year, we've talked about how your words build your relationship.
Mm-hmm.
And we've talked about how your self-talk
right.
can build your relationship. Now we're talking about a more operational standpoint of taking all of those things and putting them in the right perspective. Because we talked about your vision.
Mm-hmm.
We talked about the core values. We talked about your passions and your goals. Now, God is doing this year in this marriage ministry. To build it in a way that you could construct. If you come to us week to week or hear what we have to talk about, which is derived from God, we're building this thing where your marriage can be a lot more solid. If you just take what we've done so far, these first 4 weeks,
mm-hmm.
take this, and then we go, and then you're starting to build, and your vision, your core values, and your passions are moving in the same direction, you're building a better marriage already.
Yeah, that's very true. Yeah. And a big part of it, and I know we talk about communication a lot because communication is really important in marriage. But, you know, your communication is not going to be worth anything if you're not aligned.
Mm-mm.
It's very hard to have effective communication on topics that affect both of you if the core of the relationship, at the core, you're not both aligned. You're not on the same page. You're not in agreement. It goes right back to that scripture we used off time in Amos. How can two walk together unless they agree? And agreement and alignment really are synonymous. It's mm-hmm. the same thing. And so when we alignment just gives you sort of a different, more terminology to a different way to look at it and kind of get to understand this and kind of wrap your brain around that concept of agreement. It's critical.
It is. So when we're talking about alignment, what's things that we need to do so we can start aligning ourselves for a better marriage?
Well, the first thing that I thought of when we started looking into this topic, even before I got into the article, is that's one of those things that you need to pray about, because you need God's wisdom for how to approach the situation or how to come to a place of agreement. Because if you're already in a marriage together and you're having problems with agreement or alignment, then you need God to be that mediator for you. You're going to need God's wisdom on how to, so that you can say the right things, have the right approach, adjust yourself even to get to a place of resolution. Because, you know, if you're so focused on the fact that the two of you don't agree, I mean, that alone can be something that, you know, couples can get stuck on. Say, oh, well, you don't agree with everything I say. You got something to say against.
Right.
And, you know, in all honesty, couples can get stuck on that, on arguing about the fact that we're not aligned.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
So that prayer component is very, very important. And, you know, again, coming to a point of agreement.
Mm-hmm. Well, you invite God in to do what you can't do yourself. And mm-hmm. so if you submit to God, and you talked a little bit before we came on about vertical alignment. Mm-hmm. You going to talk about that some?
Vertical alignment. It tells us in the Bible that the woman, the wife should submit to the husband, and the husband should submit to Jesus, and Jesus, where it says Christ is ahead of the church,
right,
as man is ahead of the wife. And what, to me, that scripture says that it should be the wife, the husband, and Jesus. Mm-hmm. Am I wrong for that? Am I all right with that?
Well, I mean, Jesus is our connection to
right.
God. I don't want
to. But see, that's the spiritual alignment.
Okay.
Whether you agree with it or not, it's the spiritual alignment if you go by the Bible. Mm-hmm. But in that alignment, it has to be the spiritual way of doing it, so Jesus can do what he needs to do with the head of the household, which is God.
Yeah.
I mean, which is the husband. Mm-hmm. And then the wife submits to him, and it comes through that submission. And I submitted this point to my wife before we got started. But operationally, you know, when we do things together, it's a partnership. It's an operational alignment.
Mm-hmm.
when it comes to us.
Mm-hmm.
Here, and I get a cue from God, or she gets a cue from God because of from spiritual, from praying, and then we talk about it. That's operational. That's a partnership. That doesn't mean I'm here and what she say don't have no validity.
I was just about to ask
you. You know, that is not what I'm saying. What I'm saying, operational alignment, is we have, I don't want to use equal parts, but we are evenly partnered mm-hmm. in this relationship.
Right.
You know, I don't take more of a leadership stance in this relationship when we're doing stuff operational. But spiritually, I'm already there because I've been told by the Bible and everything that's spiritual, because that's how we run our marriage, mm-hmm. that I am the head of the household.
It's more responsibility, right. Really.
And it's all positional when it comes mm-hmm. to spirituality. But when it's talking about operationally, when we have to do things on a daily basis, we have to have that partnership. And both of us got to believe and talk about the same thing, that those core values that we were talking about,
mm-hmm.
that vision.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how we operationally align, so we can have that peace.
Right. And it goes back to righteousness. It's aligning with righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
Because once we decide that we will let God's way be what governs us, that aligns us with God. We're partnering with God.
Mm-hmm.
And so when we decide to do things God's way, that's what empowers us through Jesus. Our alignment with Jesus is what gives us that connection to have access to angelic forces.
Right.
Because the angels work, but they don't work for us unless we doing God's business, some kingdom business.
Mm-hmm.
So in order to have that power, supporting us and to have that force of the angels working with us, we have to be in alignment with God's word. And so that's really the starting point to me, is getting to that place to where we decide that I want to be in agreement with my spouse, right? Because that's what the word of God says. And so, God, I need you to help me, show me how to get to the point of agreement so that we are walking together, so that we are going to the same places, we're sharing the same vision, we're on the same path, we're working towards the same goal. We're working with each other and not against one another. And so that, to me, is kind of where it starts. You know, you still have to do the physical work between right. the two of you, but it never ceases to amaze me how God intervenes when we put him first, when we just reposture ourselves, which is really the next thing we want to talk about, is your heart posture.
All right. So when you're talking about your heart posture, both of us have to be committed to our Savior. You know, everything that we do has to be in an alignment with him in order for us to work. I don't want to keep on harping on the same thing, but it's very important that we understand that point.
I think that is a valid point. But the posture of your heart, to me, that it shows up in your attitude. It shows up in, because you can decide that you want to be in alignment with God, but if you show up to deal with your spouse and you have a disrespectful tone, or you have you bring a negativity to it, that's not a position or a posture that lends yourself to submission. It doesn't lend yourself to agreement. It makes you more argumentative.
Mm-hmm.
And that's for both, but particularly as a wife, we have to become familiar with being able to posture our heart and our emotions, to have those things in check so that we can be productive to the relationship, and so we're not doing damage against our relationship because the emotions get in the way, or because the you know, that sort of self, well, really pride can get in the way, and we have to pay attention to that and make sure that we are not being haughty, we're not damaging the relationship by the way our facial expression is during the conversation,
mm-hmm.
or tone of voice, or posture, or your body language. Yeah. All of those things can really just throw out the window the intentions you might have had to be in alignment if you don't get your body under control.
Right.
And so you have to make sure that you are physically postured, as well as your, and that starts with your heart being postured, your heart being positioned and ready for alignment through agreement.
Mm-hmm. And that's sometimes that's a tough place to be.
It takes,
you know, it takes effort.
Yeah, and to practice
to get your your non communication. Nonverbal communication out of the way, because, you know, it's hard to look at somebody's face when you're talking to them and they squinched up and you know, it's a certain way to do things.
Mm-hmm. Like that. So that wouldn't be good, would it? You talk to somebody and they're looking at you like,
well, you know, sometimes that, you know, that posture is not good if it's not, you know, complimentary to the other person's comfort level.
Do you think it's good for any conversation?
Well, you know, in some cases, you can cross your arms and look at somebody like that. You know, it can help. But if the person is uncomfortable with you doing it, I guess you shouldn't.
Okay.
And you just work on being a more pleasant person, mm-hmm. to have a conversation with, okay. based on your nonverbal cues.
Interesting.
So that's what I have had to work on. And you know, the nonverbal stuff is pretty tough, because everything is comes out of my facial expression. I might not say a word.
I think it's hard to know what your nonverbal is without there being a mirror.
Right.
I think being able to see yourself or recording yourself, and I think the same is true for tone of voice, because that's the thing for me, is the tone of voice. You know, because I can say a lot and in the way a word is said.
Right.
Or in what is not said.
Right. You know?
So, yeah, I can relate to that. That's so we both have our struggles in that department, and not so much struggles anymore, but things we've had to overcome. And we still have to be cognizant of them, I think.
That's a lot for me, though. Because, you know, some people be talking to me, I'm looking at them like...
You're frowning right now.
No, you're really not saying that to me, are you? And I have to...
But see, pull myself part of back. It, too, is your job.
Right.
So, on your job, you know, you're the heavy. You know, teachers bring them to you when they want something done. And so, you got to be, you know, the daddy discipline, you know, all the time. But when you come home, that posture has to change. That's your skill set for communicating has to change. It has to be different. And the same for me, mm-hmm. You know, the way that I'm accustomed to communicating during work is not the same.
Especially when you've been running meetings all day and you've been a certain way and you're just like, okay, I'm not.
Well, people don't oppose what I say a lot at work. Usually, at work, they're asking me for answers, you know, because of the field that I'm in.
Mm-hmm.
I'm there as a specialist to help support, you know, to bring about changes. And so usually they're looking at me for answers.
Mm-hmm.
And so I don't have to do a lot of justifying my decisions or you know, I'm a part of a team. You know, it's not like I just get my way out of town. But usually if I'm a part of the team, they're deferring to me mm-hmm. for answers based upon my professional expertise. And I don't have to, you know, pull out my degrees and try to prove anything. The people I work with trust me to make good professional decisions. And so I don't have to have people counteracting and saying, oh, well, maybe we should do it this way. Or I was thinking this and, you know.
And so we get that at the house, right?
Yes, because you have lots of opinions.
I do.
And so do I.
Mm-hmm.
And so.
So this stuff, we don't work on people. Yeah. We have actually worked on this.
Yeah, alignment has been a big issue for us mm-hmm. in the past. And we didn't know to really, I think with Bishop we did, what did he call it, same page mm-hmm. therapy? Was that it? Same page? It was same page something.
I forget what the one was.
I think it was
same page. Had to learn how to walk as one. What? It could have been same page. I'll tell you about it later. It could have been same page therapy. And we also... talked about that vertical alignment in the other mm-hmm. church we was in. We was in the part of that mm-hmm. marriage ministry.
Okay.
And we talked about vertical alignment that told us how to be
that. That's true.
In that alignment with, mm-hmm. with God.
That's true.
And that definitely helped us out mm-hmm. because I'm like, you know what? We're going to do it like this. I had to make my mind up.
And that don't fly with me very well.
Nope. And guess what I did? In my way. And it wasn't good.
How about saying what always? How did it always turn out?
It was not good. So you
and
know,
and I would let you know that you should listen to me.
Mm-hmm. But you know, also, even when you know we made some decisions on our own too, my beautiful wife, it don't quite turn out the way it should have.
Well, that's because we need to work together,
and that's
it
the
always
part,
works out better.
That's the point of this lesson. Mm-hmm. So y'all can share in our experiences what we've experienced, and just tell you this alignment thing is right. It needs to happen. You know, we have come through that little bit of turmoil, and we're better for it.
True.
All right.
And I will say lastly that if you are finding it to be an unsuccessful endeavor, I won't say you can align because you can, but if you're finding it to be more difficult than what you feel the two of you can handle, know that there are counselors available. There are mediators, you know, whether it's a couple that might be a mentor couple that can help you work through those difficulties, or if you can, you have your pastor or someone on church staff that can help with that at our church. A lot of times it's us that Bishop may refer to, or he may help, in, you know, himself. But there are people available to help you. There's resources available.
Mm-hmm.
Don't just resign to be stuck and to fail. Make up your mind that you are going to succeed. Pray about what steps to take next and go ahead and seek some additional help. Mm-hmm. If you can't get both of you to come to agreement on counseling, then what I have seen to be successful in the past, and I've heard Bishop say this as well, is work on you. You go see about getting some counseling, because once you are better, you have potential to make the marriage better. One person better in the marriage can help make the marriage better. And it's amazing how one person making positive change can inspire the other person to make some positive change as well. So never put pressure on yourself for one person to try to fix the marriage alone. That's not the point. You work on you. You work on you. You go to God, see what God will have you to do, what's going to make you better, make you stronger, make you strengthen up those areas where you have weakness. And sometimes that's enough to make the other person want to do better when they see you doing better.
Right.
Sometimes it's not enough. Sometimes it's a bigger issue than that. Mm-hmm. Any way you slice it, you will be better off than if you had not worked on yourself. It should always be a goal. I am a firm believer that you should always be working on improving yourself, studying something to make you better in some area.
And see, that goes to a story I heard from another pastor. The story is, if you change, you know, you and your wife have been going through hell and back. And if you change and you have took on this different kind of posture and you really get yourself in the Word and you start studying the Word, finding out who you need to be.
Right.
As far as the head of the house or the being in the right alignment with your husband, and you praying to God and your behavior change, if this person come to you and want to start that same old argument and you refuse to do it and you go to them and you use God's words on it, they may keep on coming. They may be trying to strike the fire with you so y'all can go together and trying to argue with you, trying to get their point across. But you are doing something different. They're going to find out what is wrong with this person. They're going to find out what's different about you. Why is this joker not fussing with me anymore?
Because the sun turns away right.
Yelling at me no more. Yeah. Why she not insulting me no more? Why he's not insulting me?
Can't argue with
you can't argue. You will not argue by yourself. And that goes to that that years ago, that movie that Kirk Cameron made, Fireproof.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Fireproof. And you people start to look at you like, why is this person different? At some point, either that person going to have to get out of your life or they're going to have to change. They're going to find out why you changing. Why are you doing this now? Mm-hmm. Why are you so different? And then you can be the person that lead them to Christ. And then that can lead your marriage out of disaster. The possibilities are there as long as you believe. So that's all it takes. Really. If one person to believe that life can be better, that this marriage can be better, whether that other person believe or not, that's on them. That's when we talked about that individual purpose in your heart. It's up to that person to do their part and coming to Jesus Christ. But if you do your part and then you lead that person to Christ, your behavior can lead them straight there.
Yeah. And the Bible even says that.
Yeah.
Unbelieving wife can win her husband over with her chaste behavior.
Wow. That's a scripture I was thinking about.
Yeah.
Just couldn't quote it.
Well, there you go.
You got it. That's why you part of my...
Part of your foot.
Part of my love life, my everything. All in all.
Okay.
Make me better.
We make each other better.
That's all.
All right. That's our time at 6:30. Well, okay. We appreciate you all for joining us. And once again, please share. Let's get this message out. We're Crown Kingdom Cultural Center. Pastor Finis Bush Jr. and Denise Bush are our pastors. And so we want to encourage you to spread the word. Come visit us. We're in North Augusta, South Carolina. Check out our Facebook page. Check us out on YouTube. We hope to see you again soon.
Okay. But that being said, my wife being a good timekeeper tonight, I love it, y'all. From the lady and the coach, we love y'all. Good night.